Okay, I'd like to call the meeting to order. This is the March regular meeting of the City of Reading's Historical Architectural Review Board. Thank you for coming this evening. While our meetings are generally informal, we do use Robert's Rules of Order to structure the proceedings and maintain decorum. The City of Reading's Code of Ordinance requires the HARB to be guided by the Secretary of Interior Standards for Rehabilitation, as well as Chapter 180, the Construction Codes, and any policies or guidelines adopted by the HARB. Attendees are asked to silence their cell phones and electronic devices until the adjournment of the meeting, and the audio and video portion of the proceedings are being recorded and broadcast. When the applicant hears the name of his or her property called, if they could please come to the front table and sign in and wait for the preservation consultant to provide a summary of the application. After the summary, the applicant will have 3 minutes to make any brief comments they'd like to make, followed by questions and comments from board members. Are there any conflicts of interest for anyone on the agenda this evening? None? Then we will proceed with the first item on the agenda, which is 110 South 6th Street, and it's the proposal for replacement of the building's main front entrance and commercial storefront entrance at the first floor front facade, as well as removal of an existing screen door at the first floor front entrance and removal of an AC unit at the transom window and replacement with clear glass.
Okay, the subject property is located in the Prince Historic District. The building is a three-story semi-attached vernacular brick building with a storefront on the first story and residential space above. The property has retained its original cornice at the roofline. The storefront features a cornice with dental molding and three-light transom over the storefront windows. The existing entry doors on the property consist of a full glass door with wood surround on the storefront and a steel door with a single light on the residential portion of the building, which appears to be a mid-20th century replacement. The composite index rating is 76, and the applicant proposes to replace the two main entry doors on the front facade of the building, the first of which accesses the residential portion of the building, while the second accesses the commercial storefront space on the first story. The existing screen door at the commercial entrance will be removed, and the existing wood full glass door will be replaced with a new full glass door with an aluminum frame. The existing door at the residential entrance will be replaced with a new six-panel steel door. The applicant also proposes to remove the existing air conditioner unit from the transom window above the door to the commercial space and to replace it with a clear glass window. As part of a separate proposal, the applicant has proposed the replacement of the existing storefront in kind, and that work has been previously approved at staff level. And the guideline citations are 2, 5, and 6. 2, the historic character of a property shall be retained and preserved. The removal of historic materials or alteration of features and spaces that characterize a property shall be avoided. Number 5, distinctive features, finishes, and construction techniques or examples of craftsmanship that characterize a property shall be preserved. And number 6, deteriorated historic features shall be repaired rather than replaced. Where the severity of deterioration requires replacement of a distinctive feature, the new feature shall match the old in design, color, texture, and other visual qualities, and where possible, materials. Replacement of missing features shall be substantiated by documentary, physical, or pictorial evidence. And the evaluation on the effect and the recommendations are the removal of the existing air conditioning unit and restoration of the transom is appropriate as presented. The replacement of the existing doors appears to be warranted given that the existing residential door is not original and the existing storefront door is in poor condition. A full glass door with a wood frame would be most appropriate for the replacement of the commercial door rather than the aluminum frame which is proposed. A wood door would also be most historically appropriate for the residential entrance. However, a steel door may be more appropriate in terms of security. Both replacement doors should match the original in size. If possible, the casing should be retained and reused. If that's not possible, it should be replaced in kind.
Thank you. Would the applicant like to make comments?
As far as the front window, It has two, there's like two side of steel, yeah, like aluminum, and that's impossible to take down. I don't know how. I mean, we would have to take the whole front out because that is a casing. And they're asking us to replace it with wood, and I don't know how that's possible. And that's been there for I don't know how many years. So all we were asking was to leave that on just like it is, and we'll replace the rest of it with wood, which that's what kind of we agreed, but now they're asking us, or I guess you guys are asking us to make it wood, and I don't know how that's possible. I really don't know.
Okay. Is the original application to leave the existing metal mullions?
Yes, their original application was to repair the window in kind, and they wanted to leave the existing mullions and add this wood framing.
Which, that's not what it is. Yeah, that's not, we got messed up. That's the inside.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's interior. The outside is like a, what is it called? Like, already, I don't know how to say it. But it's outdoor wood.
Okay.
That's just worse than it. But yeah.
And I had emailed her all the comments of the executive committee saying that this was an interior, or wood to be used on the interior. And I sent her the picture of
finished wood, outdoor finished wood. Yes, that's what it's called. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I sent her the picture of the storefront, which I forgot to print out, but that Aaron had brought up.
So are we to understand then that the proposed alterations are an in-kind replacement of the entire storefront as it exists today?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Minus the doors. I'm not talking about the doors now, but just the storefront window.
Correct.
Are you proposing to replace it in kind the way it is today?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, then that would not need to be approved by the HARB. That can be approved by the preservation officer.
The one, and I technically did approve it, but I think you were telling me that some of the wood on, if you're looking at the window on the left-hand side, was almost like not there. And that's why we were talking about proposing a wood framing. Like, what do I want to say? The stop on the window. Like, literally, you said that literally you can push on that window
and
it'll go in.
Yeah, it's plastic. It's not a window. It's just plastic.
So which portion?
So this, where the wood framing is here, this is metal here. She needs guidance as to what type of wood or what it should look like in order to frame out that window.
Okay, so that portion of the window frame will be reconstructed using wood?
Correct, but you see the metal, where the metal is?
In the
we would have to put the wood on top of it. We can't take that frame out.
Could they?
And these glass panels are being replaced?
Yes.
Yes,
in
that's
kind.
Not glass, that's plastic.
Right now it's plexiglass. But they're replacing the window full size, or
yeah, just
two.
Like it is with
glass.
With glass.
Okay.
But in I think a lot of pictures. There's just like almost nothing there.
Mm-hmm. You can see the gap there, I think.
I'm a little confused then as to why the mullions can't be removed. If the glass is being replaced, they're not structural steel. They're part of the window frame. So I'm not sure why that part couldn't be removed and reconstructed.
That's what they told me. That's exactly what they told me. That's how can that be removed? I don't know.
There may be a need for a site visit in this case.
Is there a contractor doing the work for
mm-hmm.
you?
Mm-hmm. And my husband is actually doing that part of the job. He's actually doing it. Because he doesn't care. I mean, wood is wood. We'll just buy wood. But he said that's impossible to take out. Like, that's a whole, I guess that's a part that holds the...
This metal piece.
Uh-huh. It's got a... Yeah. Because all we were going to do was cover it with wood, if you guys want wood, but how are...
The metal piece on the corner is probably structural, but the metal piece in the middle is probably not.
So how can we take out that corner and the metal?
Can we put like a wood facing on this so that it would all look...
Are there any details? Or have you proposed any jam details or sill details for how this is going to be constructed?
Yeah.
Well, no, because when Amy and I talked, we just said we were just going to replace the glass and trim it with wood. And then she sent me an email stating that we have to remove the metal part. And that's where we need to find out how, because that can't be possible.
Okay, but there is also some wood reconstruction taking place, correct? I thought that's
correct,
been established
to trim
already.
It, to trim it around the glass.
Right.
The
glass. So what form will that take? What pieces are being used to reconstruct those?
The outdoor finished wood. It's just wood from Home Depot. Not that. That's from the inside. That's what
okay,
made us...
What size and shape? We need information about that.
We need to know, like, the dimensions and the
We almost need to see plans of what you want to do to rebuild this window. When you go away from saying, I'm going to... If you're doing it exactly like it is, then we wouldn't need to see that. But now that you're changing things and you're adding wood and you're replacing glass, it's a little bit more involved rather than just walking up and saying, okay, I'm just popping out the plexiglass and popping in glass and walking away. So really, we would need to see, you know, drawings. We would need to see details as to the profiles of the wood, how you want to cap the metal, how you want to finish it, how you want to secure that piece of glass in that opening. Because right now, if you say you can just push the plastic out, you're going to need to figure out a way to secure that new glass piece in the opening. And it's all things we're going to need to see to make sure it looks historically appropriate. Unfortunately, it's not as simple as just buying a piece of glass that dimension and putting it in the opening and walking away.
Yeah. Correct.
I mean, so I commend you for wanting to do it correctly. We need a little bit more information at this point as to some more of the details as to how your husband is going to go about rebuilding and replacing. And not to say that what he's doing is wrong, we just need to know what he's thinking about doing. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Since there's already metal framing around the one pane, and it's likely that when facing the building to the left that there's metal, would it be appropriate to replace that with metal?
That's what I'm asking.
That's what she's asking for. And when the executive committee was looking, correct me if I'm wrong, we were saying, and I was telling them, you know, how beautiful this can be. And she's got a lot of original material here. So...
Because it was easier for us to just do it with metal, since that's the casing that the gentleman that's doing our glass was doing.
And originally that's what she proposed to me, and then I said, no, you have to come before the review board. So then mm-hmm. they said, no, we'll do it in wood. But then I had asked like for the trim, and that's when she brought me this, and then the executive committee said that this is interior wood, because there is literally like nothing left even on this side.
There's nothing left.
Could it be something as simple as just buying one large pane of glass and installing just a square window stop on the exterior window and putting the glass in and caulking it?
That's exactly
I don't know without a site visit.
Yeah.
It's hard to tell whether...
It would depend on the dimension of the window and what the profile is.
I can't tell if that's aluminum storefront material or if that's steel.
I see it.
And it's hard to tell how that corner mullion is attached to what's happening above it. And without a site visit or detailed drawings,
right.
it's really hard to figure out what's happening.
Well, we were told we were going to get a site visit. So right about now, we're just pretty much confused because when what I proposed was what my husband had told me, that the glass guy had told him about putting the metal frame, which he can do, just, you know, take out the plastic, put the glass, and just make it metal frame to complete. Yep.
It would look like a new
storefront.
Right, the whole one big window.
No, not the whole big window, just two. He has two pieces already. And he was going to install it and then just do the metal frame.
Would it be cheaper to do just one big piece of glass?
Yeah, that's too big.
It's insulated glass, it can't be more than 50 square feet.
Yeah, it was too, it was, I said that to Amy, I said, I'd rather it be two. I mean, we do one, one nice one, but no, they were like, whoa, it's too big.
Well, this would be, according to the window policy, it's a class three repair, which is more than just stabilization. You're actually looking at removing or altering components of the window frame itself. So typically for something like that, we would need to see scale drawings, detailed drawings of the head jam and sill conditions, as well as a site visit, which we can certainly arrange for.
And how am I supposed to do this?
Well, your window installer, whoever's providing the window frame, should be providing that information.
Yeah. Who are you buying the metal frame from and the glass from?
He is in Pascoco Avenue.
B&G Glass?
What is it?
B&G Glass?
I forgot.
B&G, yeah, they're right.
Okay. Whoever is...
It's like by the school.
Yeah, that's B&G Glass.
Yeah.
So B&G Glass can provide you those details. Just whoever you're dealing with at B&G Glass should say, I'm in front of the Historical Review Board, they want to see head and sill details, and he'll know exactly what to provide you.
Okay, but are we doing that in metal or are we doing that in wood?
Well, that's why I'm recommending that the site visit should happen probably first in this case.
Okay. Site visit could happen with B&G Glass.
It could, before they produce any detailed drawing information.
Yeah,
though.
Because then we're like, okay, what are we saying?
Right.
Would
you be amenable to meet somebody from this board and somebody from B&G Glass out, or whoever,
yeah, I think that's
whoever the contractor is, to meet at the job, and then all three can, you know, you with B&G and somebody from the board can bounce back ideas to figure out what the best way to do this is.
Because I really don't mind. I'll put what you guys are asking me to, but I just don't know where I'm at because I'm like back and forth.
Sure.
So I think that's the best way.
So why don't we pursue that approach? If you can coordinate a time through Amy,
okay,
and we'll make sure on our end that there's a representative from the board present on site at that time.
Like next week or this week? Because I'm going away next week, next Tuesday.
We should be able to schedule something this week if your installer is available.
Yeah, B&G Glass can do it. Just coordinate that with Amy. Send her some times, and then she'll get back to you.
Talk to your contractor, and just send me some times, and you can send out an email.
Sounds good.
So, with that being said, I'll make a motion to table 110 South, the certificate of appropriateness. I'm only saying because will the doors be affected by whatever we decide to do on the And might the doors also benefit from a site visit?
Is the proposal still a paneled steel door?
For the residential, exactly.
And what is the proposed door for the commercial entrance?
I have a picture of it.
Is it the glass,
the
frameless glass?
Yeah.
With top and bottom rail?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And did you get my email with the pictures of the doors that we had, the executive committee had given it as an example as appropriate door?
I'm sure I have it.
This was the picture that we had seen, which is a frameless glass commercial door. It looks like it was removed from maybe another project.
Mm-hmm.
With the intention of repurposing it in this installation. This is not typically the type of door that would be approved for this type of a storefront.
Okay.
Usually, historically, this would have been a full glass style and rail wood door. And those types of doors are still available. There are several different manufacturers that we could point you toward who could produce something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, I had sent you first.
I just thought it looked nice, so.
Did you want to explain that you were going to frame that out somehow?
Yes, that was another thing. We didn't know if we were going to get it approved or not, but we did also mention something about framing it in wood.
Which door are we talking about here?
The frame door right now.
I don't know if that's feasible.
If that's even possible. Mm.
It's a frameless glass door, so typically a door like that has pivots on the top and the bottom.
Okay.
And the frame is essentially casing with a stop. It's certainly possible to do that. Whether it's historically appropriate, I think, is a different question. And I'm not sure that the board would typically rule that that would be appropriate.
Is that glass, is it tinted, the glass? Was clear. It looked, I thought it looked like a little grayish green in there, but I couldn't really tell.
It's
it looks like it.
Okay, because I would assume clear glass would have been originally used, not like a smoky kind of finish.
Oh. And there's a picture in there of the interior, the back side of the door, so you can see mm-hmm. the configuration. Right. I don't think I have
that one.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is a commercial grade door.
It can be used commercially. It's a style and rail wood door, solid core. It does have a veneer, and veneers are available in different thicknesses. It can have commercial hardware applied to it, which in this case you would be required to have by building code. And that was another question, actually, that the executive committee raised about what type of hardware would be used on these doors.
Wow. Every door.
she would have to submit that as well.
Right. We would need product information.
It would have to be commercial. It would have to be push and pull.
Oh,
panic baller,
okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
Because to get a building permit, they're going to want to make sure that you have the...
Okay.
See
that.
If I can, do you think I can...
Oh, yeah, you can have these.
So the code official is going to want to see certain things. It has to be tempered glass. The bottom rail has to be at least 10 inches tall before any curves.
So this door right here at SimpsonDoor.com, mm-hmm. is that what it is? So this is the one, this is how you guys would approve it?
Yeah.
And
you can go to any, I don't know, call it manufacturer, distributor around that sells doors and just tell them I need a commercial grade door and they should...
Commercial grade door.
Yeah, and they should know what to quote you for that product.
Okay. Gotcha.
We can gladly let you know a couple distributors as well that would sell you. It's there's a couple good places around.
Okay, good.
So that's an approvable door type for the commercial entrance.
Okay.
And the residential entrance, there should be another cut attached there that has a wood panel door.
So the one that I showed you, the white one from Home Depot, that's not approvable?
They have been approved by the board in the past in certain instances. For an installation like this where your window frames are wood, your casing, exterior casing is wood, it's not ideal. And I think one of the issues with the submitted product is going to be the size. If it's a standard size and you have a custom size opening, which I'm assuming it is, you would want to have a door that's sized appropriately for that opening and that's installed appropriately. So rather than having, for example, a brick mold that's pre-applied to the outside of the door frame, you would want to remove the existing casing first, install the new door and frame, and then put the existing casing back on the outside, or replicate the existing exterior casing.
Not just install a door, what do you call it, pre-hung?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Pre-hung with a door.
Correct.
That's what your specification said.
The other issue with the pre-hung door is typically they're, I think what you're submitting is a residential grade door there, which has its own durability issues. But the other problem is they often have a pre-applied saddle or threshold. And in the case of commercial building code, that would be problematic because it has to meet accessibility requirements. So for both, if you're a multi-unit, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so for both doors, you would have to have a commercial grade saddle.
Okay.
These are all building code requirements that you can have discussions about with the building code official. We're not necessarily as concerned about the hardware as we are about the historical appropriateness of the doors themselves.
Okay, so this is the door that I'm supposed to buy.
We're suggesting that as an option.
That is an approvable option, okay. Just like the door behind that in the package is as well.
Okay, these two, okay,
yes.
Okay. So you can have a solid wood door.
It's a solid wood door that I would say about, mm-hmm. Right?
Window so, lights in it, yeah.
We really work on anything at this point until she figures out which direction that she wants to go.
Since there's already going to be a site visit, why not address everything? I have a full completed application presented at the next visit, and it sounds like it should be pretty easy to do at that point in time, just to approve everything.
It sounds like the right approach. Are you okay with that?
Yeah.
So what we would do is table the application for now, perform the site visit, allow you some time to collect some product data, and then get back to us with your drawings.
Okay, sounds good. I just need to know, like he mentioned, like some places, because we're kind of lost.
Maybe
I'll get a place
for you.
Okay.
So would someone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to table the certificate of appropriateness for 110 South 6th Street to be reviewed at a later date.
And a second.
One second.
Thank you. Ms. Lasota?
Yes.
Ms. Weller?
Yes.
Mr. Devine?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
And Mr. Sands?
Yes.
So the motion is approved. We'll table the application, and that you can communicate with Amy Johnson about scheduling a site visit.
Sounds good.
All right.
Thank you
for coming in.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Right on the.
Don't worry about him.
Do you want your pictures back?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Is that okay if I keep it? Okay, thank you. We'll be in touch.
Okay.
Can I propose to table that 10 minutes?
You are trying your hardest.
Yes, you are.
Next item on the agenda is applications reviewed at staff level. Are there any questions or comments?
I make a motion to approve the applications that were already approved at staff level.
And a second.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion is carried. Moving on to other business, the preservation officer's report on action items.
I'm just going to go over the ones that I have worked on. I have been finally able to talk to the law office, although they're not able to reveal a lot to me about 612 Franklin Street, and that is the stucco, and the stucco was removed and it hasn't gone any further. Apparently they're doing an investigation as to the manner in which the stucco was required to be removed, so there's an issue there, and that's about all I can say. So right now it is at a standstill until it is fully investigated. I think it's along the lines of whether the owner is responsible for it or the city is responsible for it. So, towards the end, I made a mistake or did not keep a copy of the letter, but in any case, for 406 Douglas Street, I have a letter, I promise, set ready to go out tomorrow. They had started to construct like a rear roof or a roof over the rear entrance, and we had in the end of 2014, the board had denied what construction they did so far, but they went and completed it. So I'm sending out a non-compliance slash violation letter, which they'll have to respond to. And then the same with the 200 North Fifth Street. I've actually been working with the zoning inspector, or one of the zoning inspectors on that property, with signage. They've gotten, they've started to put additional signage in the windows. So she has sent them a non-compliance letter from zoning, and she's gotten them to remove the signage from the windows. And but my letter is going to address the green marble trims, as Peter brought. I think it was last month, that it strictly says, or specifically says in the resolution, that they were not supposed to drill into it and break it, and of course it's broken. And then there's one that we have not reviewed, but I wanted to bring to your attention, that I've been working on also with the zoning inspector, 500 Buttonwood Street, which is actually, it's also known as 355 North Fifth Street. But this is the Fifth Street facade. Mm-hmm. And for several years, actually, I've been working on this sporadically. And we have been citing the owner left and right for, actually, this sign frame he put up, and now that is down. But he's got a fence that he built. He's got bars that have shown up on the windows, multiple signage. And we had a court hearing in January 14th, not that it matters. And he didn't show up, so we cited him again. And
So wait, what happens when he didn't show up?
He is fined in absentia, $300 for each citation. So there was four citations being looked at that court hearing. And I recently received, he's appealing all four of them to the next higher court. So I haven't gotten my summons or whatever you call it to go to court, but he's appealing that. And then we're continuing to cite him. We had a court hearing last Thursday, and he didn't show up for that. So he's being fined in absentia for that too, which he'll probably appeal.
I didn't think you could appeal if you didn't show up for your hearing.
Apparently you can.
So does an appeal then like negate or stop or pause the fine process, or does that just continue to go?
No.
Okay.
I've learned from the zoning inspector, because she was in the codes office previous to being in our office, we can sign a site every day if we wanted to. So that's what we cited on, like, for instance, September 22nd, September 28th, October 7th, and November 4th.
So what's the fine total to date? Do you know?
I don't know.
Okay. I mean, that day alone cost him $1,200,
right?
Yeah.
Right, yes. Yeah.
Just that missed court date.
Yes.
Yeah, just one.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
So it's well into the thousands.
That, right,
yeah.
Yes, yeah. Instead of just, and I received a phone call from his lawyer actually today asking what he needs to do to comply. And I told the judge it's a simple matter of filling out an application that he sent, and, you know, or he's been sent many violation letters, and he just chooses to ignore everything. So,
well, you've actually had conversation with him too, and he's basically said, "Sign me, find me all you want. You're not getting anything."
Yeah, right. Yeah, he said, "Go ahead." Basically, yeah.
And how long has he owned? How long has he been the building owner? Do you know?
He used to be in the
304 North Fifth Street.
Right, 304 North Fifth, and then he moved, which is going to be another conversation in about 5 minutes because of what they did there.
Oh, really?
That's just it.
Okay.
It's what's missing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I took pictures.
Anything else?
Nope, that's it.
All right, let's move on to the board member reports from May 2015 resolutions. Mm-hmm. I had 624 Laurel Street, which is the market on Laurel, the commercial storefront. They removed the glass block and installed the full glass door with the anodized aluminum frame in dark bronze as required by the resolution. The sign was also installed. It's a bracket-mounted sign. It is not interior illuminated, and it appears that everything was executed according to the resolution. I also wanted to note that on that visit, I passed by the St. Peter's School.
Okay.
And that work does not appear to be in compliance with the resolution. The cornice was reconstructed
mm-hmm. okay.
in its entirety. And I believe there was some temporary work that was going to take place, followed by some submission of compliant moldings that would be approvable at staff level, I believe.
I'll have to look back on this, but yeah.
Well, he gave us a template that he was going to use to rebuild, and the template was pretty darn close to what was
yes.
up there initially, and I think
we
drew it on the board here that night, how he was going to do it, and we approved him based off of that template, so he didn't.
But then he showed us the exact
template. We made him make a template, and then he made a template, and he put the template, I mean, he drew out the existing profile, and he put the template right up against, and it was within
pretty close.
A half inch, a quarter inch of what was existing, and I said, yeah, absolutely, if it's going to look like that, go for it.
Yeah.
So you did a site visit of
yes.
that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I'd like to look at it with you afterward, if mm-hmm. we could. Ms. Lasota?
I had 836 Sutter Avenue, and it was to replace the first floor front porch roof and the roof over the second floor bay window and the Philadelphia gutter with either lead-coated copper or raw copper. From what I saw, it looks like it's lead-coated copper. It's not the bright, shiny copper, but the work was done on the porch,
the bay,
lead-coated. It's not the bright, shining.
Well, it has started to patina, but it's regular copper.
I got that in and think it was there.
Is it?
It's very dull already. And then, of course, the Philadelphia gutter he did overlap, so.
It's 836?
836 Center.
That sounds popular.
And the other one was 428 Minor Street. They were going to build. This is what it looked like, and Amy gave us the pictures. And
still
this is what it looks like today. It's still the same.
Still the same, okay. I think the last time I saw him, the contractor had come in for a zoning permit, and I don't think he ever got a zoning permit. I don't think anything had proceeded.
Well, it's more trash in the yard, and the cinder blocks are standing there, and nothing's been done.
Okay. And it was elective.
Mr. Devine?
I had 230 South 6th Street. This was a gentleman that wanted to install the door in the grocer's alley. Regardless of what we approved or what he was supposed to do, what he did do was just put a slab of plywood custom into a frame. So that was definitely not approved. Really just took a piece of plywood and hinted it on there with a padlock. That's really all that he did. So, I mean, I have a picture of that. I can send it to you.
Okay, perfect. And that was 230 South 6th?
Yes.
Okay.
Did that come as a violation?
No, he applied for it. Just what he was supposed to do, he didn't do.
I remember, him discussing that he had problems with his tenants, like breaking the door. And
mm-hmm. Is it possible that it's a temporary installation?
I can
That's what it sounds like. Did it look like it was trying to be permanent?
There's no way to really tell that. I mean, what I saw was just a slab of plywood hinged on it. On the door frame with a padlock, so I don't know what is intended.
So you'll follow up.
Yeah, I'll give him a call.
Did you have another one?
No, that was the other one.
Mr. Sands,
I had 722 North 5th. The replacement of the existing straight edged slate shingle at the main front porch with asphalt architectural shingle, and the replacement of an architectural shingle at the rear main roofing kind. They did replace the roof, and it was a relatively attractive roof job, but I don't know if I would consider that an architectural shingle roof. Would you? It looks more like a slate line.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. I can't tell from the distance.
You probably would know.
I'll tell you what it is. It's a slate line.
Yeah, it looked more like a slate line.
I had asked them to do a slate line to match the neighbors or something, maybe.
I mean, it's very attractive looking. I can email you the photo, so I don't think there's really an issue.
Okay.
I prefer the slate line on the house versus the architectural, but that's not what the resolution says. So.
Unless there was a later, would there have been a later resolution? I don't know.
Yeah, because that's always possible, but mm-hmm. I can't remember that.
But the work was complete, so I will email you the photo.
I remember going round and round, because there was asphalt shingles on it, and going around because they were working, it was hail damage, mm-hmm. and they were working with their contractor.
Okay, so I'll email it over to you.
Thank you. Mr. Hart?
Okay. I finally got caught up. First one, 521 Oley, replacement of the main roof. They proposed to replace scallop slate with asphalt. Everything is done except they were told that the carriage house scalloped shingles, except for the small area at the third floor gable at the front facade and the pent roof above the second floor bay window, that are currently straight-edge slate shingles. For those, a straight-edged asphalt shingle shall be used. They did not do that. They used the same shingles on the entire roof, which was a certainty to Hatteras. Does it matter? I don't know, but they did. Also, they were told they need to replace a missing finial on the third floor front dormer to match. They did not. So all the dormers have finials, except for the one on the front. /319 North 5th Street signage was done appropriately. That was the Liberty Tax Service. 200 North 5th Street, we tabled installation of two aluminum gates. No gates were put up. And 34 South 5th Street was the rebuild of the building because it collapsed. Everything was done. It was done nicely. They talk about the the mortar to be used in the brick. I don't know because they painted it, so there's no way of telling what the mortar is. The only thing that does not look good there is the metal supports that they had to drill in to the floor to hold the wall up. They didn't paint them.
Which property is this again?
34 South 5th. It's the one right in the corner, that orange one.
Yeah, the one that fell out.
So they have four supports that they drilled into the floors and metal plates on the front of the building holding the wall up. And the whole building is orange, and these metal plates are metal plates. They didn't paint them.
They're galvanized steel.
Yeah, it would make so much more sense for them to paint them orange. But you can, I mean, they stick out like an eyesore right now.
What shape are they?
They're diamond. Yeah. Well, they're diamond, but some are square and some are diamond. I mean, they're all different.
Like angles, kind of?
Yeah, they're all different directions on the building. There's no rhyme or reason why they did it. So it just looks awkward. I mean, I know why they did it, but it doesn't look finished.
Right. Yeah. I haven't seen that.
Like tiebacks, you mean?
The tiebacks aren't finished. They're just there. So that was all I had, but Amy, two that I want you to look into, 304 North 5th, the one with that beautiful cloth awning.
Mm-hmm.
They tore the awning down.
Oh, okay.
It's gone. And it looks like
cool. Yeah, because I think part of the reason the awning was there was to hide that, because years and years ago they infilled. There was probably double windows or something.
Yeah, 304 North 5th. It's empty now, but
the awning was in rough shape.
Well, hopefully the frame is still on hand somewhere.
I doubt it. That's a drug house now. So, the other one, Amy, that we need to think about is 47 North 5th Street. It is right across the street from the Lincoln Hotel.
and they have a trash problem.
Okay.
They have four or five trash cans out front, and I can't tell you how many times I drive past that property and the garbage is halfway out onto the sidewalk. Just, the garbage cans are full, the trash is on. I don't know if they're not getting it emptied enough. I don't know if they don't have enough capacity. I don't know, but 75% of the time when I drive by, it looks absolutely horrendous. And it's a business. It's that soulmate business over there.
Oh. Yeah, there's a lot of apartments.
I know, and it's just, it's horrible. I mean, they have sofas out front. I mean, all the garbage just goes right up front against the building, and it's just, in that prominent block, it looks horrendous.
I never had that problem before. Like, I've never.
No, it's only started in the last month.
Have you made a complaint or anything?
No.
I mean, I can put one in.
No.
Would that violation notice come from property maintenance?
Yes.
I just thought of it when I was looking at the link, looking there.
Thank you. Ms. Weller.
Okay. I had a 422 Penn Street. The construction of wood walkway and steps adjacent to the eastern facade of the building. Installation of double entrance doors and windows at the southern end of the eastern facade of the building. Installation of light fixtures, the eastern facade, and installation of signage at the front facade. And that work has not been done. Amy, I think you said it's still waiting for codes approval.
Yeah.
Is that correct? Okay.
It's gotten approval by trades, but he wants to use the facade improvement.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay. All right. So it could be
so
a little bit of time till.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. And then the next one was for 540 Penn Street, the replacement of the existing wall-mounted light fixture and the installation of one recessed light fixture. So I took some pictures, showed them to Amy. You'd said that there was a resolution that came after that.
Yes.
So there were two sort of like sconce types, sort of like half-cylinder sconces, and then kind of a projected. So I think in the later resolution, those were not part of the application,
right?
So they're still intact.
Right.
And then the approvals for the installation of what, emergency lights, kind of in that ceiling area right by the door. You sent me that resolution. The only thing I think it was supposed to be like an aluminum color,
yes,
the light fixture. This appears to be like a cream or an ivory color.
Okay.
And of course, I think it's offset a little so that the door can open.
Right.
I think
instead
the resolution
be centered. Center,
right, but it really can't be centered,
no,
or else the door would hit it.
Right.
So, I think this. I would say that it was primarily done, but the finish is different than what than what the approval was for. So
should I send a letter for the finish? Or you want to look
at
it?
It's an off-white color. I have a photo here if you want to see it.
It's
not that bad. This times out really fast.
Okay. It's fairly low profile.
It is, yeah. And completely functional as opposed to aesthetic. I think it blends in okay with the
material
in the building.
Yeah, it's right up against the frame.
Yeah.
But wasn't there something in the resolution about doing an either-or scenario where this would function as an emergency fixture or that one would?
I didn't read that. I have it right here.
Yeah, because you have the later one.
It does seem redundant.
Mm-hmm.
It's to install one service-mounted light fixture in the ceiling of the primary lobby recess at the front facade. The light fixture, well, it tells about the light fixture. It must be silver in color, flush-mounted, and centered on the existing soffit. All the other existing lighting at the front facade is to remain. Because their original
was
to remove all of it, and we said no to their proposed light fixtures. And then they came back and said, okay, we'll leave everything intact, but we need this flush-mounted light fixture.
Mm. Okay. Well, I mean, it would be up to the board whether or not to pursue anything with that. You might want to send that photo around.
Do they just have to touch it to keep it going?
Yeah, kind of. Move fast.
Like hot potato.
Yeah. Real quick.
No, I'll give this to you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, it's an ivory and it was supposed to be a white.
It's supposed to be
like a aluminum or stainless,
aluminum,
right?
Finish.
Yeah.
Or, yeah.
But like you said, it kind of matches the material.
Yeah, it does.
It?
Yeah.
You'll see.
It does kind of.
Where I think the silver profile might actually stand out more.
Yeah.
Oh, the only thing the silver would do is match what's on the exterior right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With it being off, I think it might draw too much attention to it if it matched the doors. That's just my opinion.
I would agree with that.
I mean, I don't have an issue with the way with the material. I don't know how everyone else feels, but yeah. I think it's okay.
Sounds like there's consensus.
Do I not get a vote?
Oh yeah,
you got it.
Sorry.
Apparently not.
You're okay.
Did you have another?
No.
Okay. Ms. Johnson, do you have resolutions from June and July?
And I think you had said, or I had my notes August too, so if you want just June and July, but here's
we're falling behind. So
all 3 months.
We can each take them off. we can each take half a month.
Oh, the staff approvals are in there too, so you don't have to take those. You don't have to take them out.
Is that my hand on that?
Yep. Okay.
Do we not check staff approvals? We don't, do we?
No.
No, honestly, most of them are done. What I've ever seen are done, according to what painting.
While those are going around, let's move on to the HARB training session. Mr. Devine was able to secure the artifacts bank, so the Center Park Historic District headquarters, for our training session. So we do have the artifacts bank, and Mr. Lauder was kind enough to offer to open it up after our session is complete for anybody to tour the space,
okay,
if they'd like that opportunity. I know we did that last year as well. And we did have some communication about the content of our training session. Perhaps Ms. Leggio would like to comment on what's being planned for the training.
Yes. So I've got a good list of contractors that Amy and Aaron provided. I'm actually going to start reaching out to them tomorrow. But we're going to put something together about materials, replacement techniques, and costs associated with various techniques for as many materials as we can get representatives for.
And we'll also be working on a financial economic hardship presentation from the policy committee for that session as well. So keep you posted on that as it develops.
The one thing, if I may
sure.
add, I had said, suggested, because it was suggested to me, to open it up to like inviting council members and maybe the mayor's office, and I didn't know how you felt about that, or community members like Mike Ladd or anybody from the Artifacts Bank.
As long as they understand that it's a training session, it's not a public presentation, it's not a public meeting, there won't be voting, there's no regular business being discussed. It's really, this is intended to be a board retreat.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't think we should open it up to the general public or...
I'm just asking because I was told to ask or to throw it out there, so...
How many do you guys have over there? We have like 10 each.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what, this is 404-406 Penn Street for the stone veneer.
I have
that
one too.
That hasn't been done.
I have this one too. I have that one too.
I can hand this one back
in.
A
couple of months,
get another
one.
I have a couple other ones that I want to ask you about, so this one's valid.
So if you have more that you want
to I'm going through to figure out which ones are valid and which ones aren't, so give me a second or two.
So is the consensus to not involve other members of the community?
Because if you recall, the mayor's office sent a representative to our class, and he actually learned a lot, so.
Right.
But.
I I don't feel strongly that there shouldn't be outside members, provided that there's an understanding about the content of the session ahead of time. I wouldn't open it to the general public.
No, I wouldn't either. But you know, I think an invite to the others that you mentioned, and also remind them to come to board meetings too. I mean, there's a lot that can be learned and seen here, so. Sure. Yeah.
It's a courteous invitation.
That's
you're invited.
To the mayors and city council, or?
Well, that would be up to the board. I don't know. I mean.
How do you feel? Or if you feel strongly,
I feel
now?
Like the way Aaron does. I don't care as long as they respect that it mm-hmm. is a requirement for us. Okay. You know, it's not a fun day.
Right.
What about members of the Center Park Historic District, since we're using their space?
My suggestion for that would be this information can be used for a future community interest meeting that they host.
That's a good idea.
Yep.
Right now, I think tomorrow there's one about Charles Evans Cemetery as an educational standpoint, so this information could be used for future community interest meetings.
So what about them joining us?
Save it for the community interest meetings. Yeah,
that's a good idea. I mean, the potential benefit of having administrative and council members present is their educational opportunity.
I would say open it up to administrative council members, city employees, period. And then not community members, not, you know, anything like that. But I mean, I think it's beneficial for the city to be involved, but I don't think we need community members there, because then they just, we take the chance that they're going to ask a lot of questions. They're not going to understand things like, you know, no offense to, if she would have been at the meeting tonight, I mean, we threw around a lot of technical terms that we all understand, but, you know, community members might not understand what half those terms are, so they're just, yeah, I would say open it up to the city, not to the general public.
In that case, too, I think it'll be important for us to have an agenda and to stick to it during the meeting, because lengthy discussion could tax us during mm-hmm. that session. Mm-hmm.
And I forget, was it time? I know we said the 23rd. Was it the time set?
I had from
was
10 it? To 2.
10 to 2, okay, that's what I thought.
May 23rd, right?
April
23rd. We were talking about May. It moved to April.
Yeah, I have 10 to 2.
10 to 2, okay. Thank you.
Earth Day.
Can I interrupt? We have four more. Tell us if you want any. 450 Douglas, 1053 Madison, 412 Windsor, 442 South 7th.
I mean, Douglas sounds good to me.
Okay.
I have 408. Yeah, I have 408 South 5th, so I'll do the 442 right. South 7th.
And then, Aaron, can I ask you whether or not you want us to look at these, the rest of them? St. Peter's School, we discussed that.
We'll discuss that afterwards.
Yeah, so that's that one. And that one. And then St. Margaret's Roman Catholic Church.
That's, they had their appeal and that was mm-hmm. approved by council. Yeah.
Right, do we still need to check it?
No. Is that it? Okay, let's move to the preservation commendations for historic preservation month.
It's just my yearly reminder that May, which is National Preservation Month, is coming up, and usually by April I like to have a set list of commendations, of which Aaron and I, of course, any of the board members can attend at a city council meeting, which I have to set up yet with city council. But if you can get me, I had thrown a suggestion, I don't want to say it on the air, but I'd thrown a suggestion out in my email, and I got your email, Sean. But yeah, please send me any as soon as possible, and I can take pictures of them, and then we can review them at the next month's meeting and decide which are to receive awards.
So we'll have to vote on that at the April meeting.
Okay.
Okay, Education and Outreach Committee report.
I am just waiting for some feedback from board members on the content that I sent out. If I don't get any information, we'll just keep following that sort of structure and keep moving with building content for the site. We'll start getting a little more serious about maybe selecting some images for the whole page. Yeah, I know. It's just a matter of doing it right. Yeah. And so we're just continuing to sort of do what we're doing. If any comment, I'd appreciate it. Otherwise, we'll, if you prefer to see it in a little more finished form, we have to talk to Henry about, as we're building this content, whether we can gradually transition it in or do it all as one. You can kind of see it sort of like a beta version or something, I suppose, or something along those lines, if you prefer to see it sort of in place and see how it's operational. But it would be nice to get some comment before we start loading all of that information in there. Some will be familiar, some is definitely. Navigationally, that's where the changes are you're gonna see the biggest changes.
I think a proof would be helpful.
Okay.
Seeing it in graphic form.
Sure. Yep.
I did read through it.
Okay.
And I do have some comments on content, but I just haven't had a chance
no
to
problem.
Forward those.
Okay,
to you.
No problem.
Any comments related to that? Policy committee report?
For the past year, about a year now. It's about a year now. We were looking at how the financial hardship, economic hardship policy would be derived, what the application would look like. We got to the point where we're actually reviewing, but we wanted to dive into current or past court processes to make sure that we could substantiate what we were doing and that it actually had some grounds on. So we spent some time discussing past Supreme Court rulings and how it looked in our environment, and still kind of going back and forth on that a little bit to see where we stand.
So we'll be presenting on that on the 23rd. We were kind of hoping to be in a little more refined place in the process at that point. I'm not sure we'll be quite where we want to be, but we'll have plenty of information to share, and I'm sure it will generate some good discussion. That brings us to the end of the agenda. I feel like I'm missing something.
Strangely short.
Would someone like to make a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
I will second.
Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you, folks.
Thank you.